before inviting Dr. Jane Goodall to join me on the scene, a few words to introduce her and her biography. At the age of 26 years old, Jane Goodall traveled from her home in the United Kingdom to Tanzania, beginning what was to become world-renowned research into the lives of wild chimpanzees. She was the first, amongst others, to document the making and the use of tools. Up until then, it was thought to be a unique human trait. The list of honors and recognitions of Dr. Jane Goodall is really too long to go through this evening. But of course, we should all know that Dr. Goodall is more than a scientist. She's also an activist. Today, Jane Goodall spends more than 300 days a year tirelessly promoting conservation and peace. Reaching out to young people is one of the priorities of Dr. Goodall, undoubtedly. Conservation education, education in a general sense, is a critical part of her work. Jane Goodall hears firsthand the voices of the young people from Tanzania to China, from North America to the United Kingdom, speaking for their need of change, their hopes, and their determination to make a better world. She carries their messages all over the world and also tonight here in Heidelberg. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome with me Dr. Jane Goodall. Evening. Yeah. So before, indeed, before the speech of Dr. Goodall, we have a short film, yeah. I think. Indeed. A little trailer, yeah. Indeed. So let's watch this film. Okay, thank you.
She does seem frail, but at the same time, she's tough as nails.
I simply call her, she's a walking angel.
I can sometimes recapture what it was like to sit here when I was a young girl. Everything I saw was new and exciting. This was when my dream began. I would grow up, I would go to Africa, I would live with animals, I would write books about them. If we are the most intellectual creature that's ever walked on the planet, how come we're destroying that planet? Now it was time for me to do something. We must learn to live in peace and harmony, not only with each other, but with the natural world. It's the young people who give me the most hope. We do have the time left. We all have to get involved. We all have to make little decisions in our daily lives.
Never forget that every single day that you live, you make a difference, you impact the world.
This is my hard work. I had to do something.
Well, good evening, everybody. It would be lovely if I could speak German, but I can't. However, I am going to greet you in a different sort of a language, and I'm going to bring into this space for the first time the call, the greeting that you would hear if you came with me to Gombe National Park and climbed the hills in the morning. Hello. And I think you heard an answer down here, which is probably Shadrach Kamenya, who comes with us from Tanzania, who works in Gombe National Park as Director of Conservation. And also with me, Lawrence Knauer, who made this film, Jane's Journey, and if you haven't seen it, well then, I hope you do, because the photography is out of this world, the sound is out of this world, and Lawrence put an enormous amount of his life into making this film. And Monica Lischka, his wife, who is running the Jane Goodall Institute in Germany. That's my little team that's here with me, giving support tonight. And first of all, I'm really happy to be here. I'm really happy to be part of this first award ceremony for a corporation that really is walking its talk. And I know that for a fact, and I'll come back to it later. But there are corporations we all know out there today who say that they're doing an awful lot of wonderful things to make the planet a better place. It helps them sell their products. They want to look good. We call it greenwashing. But Heidelberg Cement is not greenwashing. It's actually doing what it says it's doing. And I know because I've been there and I've seen it. But I want to first of all go back to the very beginning. And how did this all begin? And it starts when I was a tiny little girl, always loving animals. I don't know where that love of animals came from, but I seem to have been born with it. And how lucky I was that I had an amazing mother. I don't believe for a moment that we can choose the family into which we're born. That's a little bit esoteric. But I hit lucky. I was born into a wonderful family. We had very little money. We couldn't afford even a bicycle, but I had this wise mother who understood the right way to raise a child, at least this child. She supported my love of animals. When she came into my room when I was 1.5 years old and found I'd taken a whole handful of wriggling earthworms into my bed, instead of, ugh, throw these dirty things out, she just said quietly, "Jane, if you leave them here, they'll die. They need the earth." And we carried them back together into the garden. And then we lived in London. And when I was about 5 years old, there was this wonderful opportunity for a holiday in the country on a farm. And here's this animal-loving little girl face-to-face meeting cows and pigs and horses. And in those days, there was no intensive farming. The animals were roaming around in the fields the way they should, and hopefully one day again they will. I was given a job to help collect the hen's eggs. And again, no battery farms in those days. So I would go around, there were little hen houses where they were supposed to lay their eggs. Sometimes it was out in the hedges, but mostly in these little hen houses where they also slept at night. And I would open the lid of the nesting box, and if there was an egg, I popped it into my basket. Well, apparently, I was asking everybody, I don't remember, but I was asking everybody, where does the egg come out of the hen? Because here's the egg. I couldn't see a hole that big. I looked and I looked. You can look and look. You won't see a hole like that on a hen either. At any rate, I decided I would have to find out for myself. So one afternoon I saw this hen and she was climbing into her nest box, into her hen house, and I crawled after her, big mistake, and with squawks of, I suppose, fear, she flew out. And even though I was only five, and this I remember so clearly, this is not a good place to see a hen lay an egg. It's now a frightening place. So I went into an empty hen house, hid in the straw in the corner, and waited. And waited. And waited. Which was fine for me, but my poor family, they didn't know where I was. They became frantic. They even called the police. And then finally, there's my mother. You can imagine how desperate she was. She sees this excited little girl rushing towards the house, all covered with straw. And instead of getting angry at me, how dare I go off without telling anyone, which would have killed the excitement, she saw my shining eyes and she sat down to hear the wonderful story of how a hen lays an egg. Now look back at that story. Isn't that the making of a little scientist? Curiosity, asking questions, not getting the right answer, deciding to find out for myself, making a mistake, not giving up, and learning patience. It was all there when I was 5 years old, and all of that might have been destroyed if I'd had the wrong kind of mother. She continued to help me, She knew my love of animals. She found books for me about animals, thinking that'll teach Jane to read more quickly, which of course she was right. And I think I was about 10 years old when I found this book. It was in a secondhand bookshop because we couldn't afford new books. And it was called Tarzan of the Apes. Now, you all know Tarzan. I took that book back home and climbed up my favorite tree and I read it from cover to cover. And I read it again, and I read it again. And of course, being, you know, a romantically minded little girl, I fell in love with this glorious Lord of the Jungle. And what did he do? He married the wrong Jane. So I was very, very jealous. But I mean, of course, I knew there wasn't a Tarzan. That was where my dream began. I will grow up, go to Africa, live with animals, and write books about them. Well, everybody laughed. Now we're going back, what are we going back, 60 years or something. And that was when World War II was raging, when my father was fighting your father's or grandfather's or whatever it was. I mean, how strange is that to think about today? And maybe some of you out there have lived through it and know what it's like today. But anyway, World War II was raging. My father was off fighting. I've already said we had very little money. Africa was the dark continent back then, very far away. We didn't know much about it. And I was the wrong sex. I was just a mere girl. And back then, girls didn't have that sort of opportunity. So everyone laughed and said, Jane, why don't you dream about something you can achieve? But not my mother. She would say, if you really want something and you work hard and you never give up, you find a way. When I left school, my friends mostly went to college, but we couldn't afford it. So again, it was my mother. She said, well, we can just about afford for you to do a secretarial course. Do that, then maybe you can get a job in Africa. And that's what I did. I was invited out to Kenya by a school friend. To get the money for the fare, I had to go home. I had a job in London. I went home and I worked as a waitress in a hotel around the corner, and I saved up my wages and I saved up my tips. It took a long time, but eventually I had enough money and I could set off on this amazing adventure. At that point, I was 23 years old. We're going back to 1957. And I arrived in Africa, in Kenya, stayed with my friend, heard about the very famous Louis Leakey. He's famous if you know anything about paleontology, or he spent his life searching for the fossilized remains of early humans. And I went to see him at the museum, and he asked me so many questions about all the stuffed animals and creatures. And because I had done exactly what my mother suggested, I'd gone on reading about Africa and animals, learning about them, spending hours in the Natural History Museum in London. So when there I was in the Natural History Museum in Nairobi in Africa, I could answer many of his questions. And he gave me a job as his secretary. Wise mother, you see. And that led to him realizing that I was the person he said he'd been looking for 10 years. Somebody who would go out into the wild and try to learn about chimpanzees. At that time, we knew nothing about chimpanzees in the wild, absolutely nothing. But he argued, if we believe in a common ancestor, an ape-like, human-like creature about 6-7 million years ago, then he reckoned if I found behavior that was similar or maybe the same in humans and chimpanzees today, then maybe that same behavior was present in the common ancestor and we had brought it with us in our two separate evolutionary pathways. That, he felt, would help him to have a better guess at how early man might have behaved. So that's why he sent me out there. But it wasn't very easy. Of course, I said, yes, wow, this is my dream, more than my dream. Not studying just any animal, but the one most like us. But who was going to give money? Back then, a young girl, no degree, straight from England. Well, eventually an American businessman said, all right, Lewis, here's money for 6 months. We'll see how she does. But then there was another problem. Back then, what is Tanzania today was still known as Tanganyika. It had been German East Africa, and Britain took it over as a protectorate after World War I. And the British authorities, in what was still part of the British colonial empire, were not prepared to take responsibility for this young girl. They said no, but Lewis never gave up. And in the end, they said, oh, all right, she can come, but she must come with someone. So who volunteered to come with me? For the first 4 months, it was that same amazing mother. This is why I say, you know, I was so lucky. She did something wonderful for me, because in those early days, the chimpanzees had never seen a white ape before, which is what I was, and they would take one look and run off into the vegetation. And although I'm living in my dream world, the forest at Gombe National Park is beautiful. Some of you have been there. It's on the shores of Lake Tanganyika, the eastern shores, and it's a little paradise. But I knew that if I didn't see something exciting before that first 6 months' money ran out, that would be the end of the study. And I would have let Lewis Leakey down. But it was my mother. When I got back in the evening, she would boost my morale. She would say, but Jane, you are learning a lot. Think, from that peak that you found, you're sitting there, you're seeing how the chimpanzees move around by themselves sometimes, or in small groups, or groups that look like mothers and their family. You've seen how small groups will sometimes all gather together when there's a delicious food. You're learning about the different foods that they eat. You're learning how they make a sleeping platform or nest up in the trees every night. She said, you're learning a lot. So it was really sad that she had to leave before the first real breakthrough observation, which you heard about, chimpanzee using and making tools. And I never forget, I saw this chimpanzee who was the first one to begin to lose his fear of me, and I named him David Greybeard, had a beautiful white beard. And I saw this dark shape crouched over a termite mound, and I saw a hand reach out and pick a piece of grass stem, and I saw him push it down into the termite mound and slowly pull it out and eat off the termites that were clinging on. And then I saw him do something even more exciting, pick a leafy twig and carefully strip away the leaves to make that twig suitable for use as a tool, the beginning of tool making. And because we were known at that time as man the toolmaker, when I sent a telegram to Lewis Leakey telling him what I'd seen, he said, ha ha, now we have to redefine man, redefine tool, or accept chimpanzees as humans. So it was sad that my mother had left just before this amazing observation. And from that time, the future of the research was assured. Lewis was able to ask National Geographic Society for money for me to continue when that first little grant ran out. And we're now 54 years later, an unbroken study since 1960, the longest unbroken study of a group of known individuals in the world. And looking back over these 50 plus years, I think perhaps the most amazing thing is how like us these chimpanzees are. They are biologically more like us than we ever dreamed of back in 1960. We didn't know then that the DNA, the structure of the DNA of chimpanzees and humans differs by only just over 1%. And my geneticist friends tell me that the main difference is in the expression of the genes, and that can be influenced by the environment. We didn't know back then exactly the similarities between the blood, the composition of the blood, and the immune system of humans and chimpanzees, which is why chimpanzees have been used in medical research to search for cures and vaccines of diseases which otherwise are unique to us. And we didn't know back then that the brain, the structure, the anatomy of the brain of human and chimpanzee is almost identical. It's just that ours is a bit bigger. These were not the things that interested me. They're fascinating, but they still don't really interest me except in a sort of logical way. But what fascinated me and still does is the similarities in behavior. And there isn't time to go into all of these, but let's just take non-verbal communication. Kissing, embracing, holding hands, patting on the back, swaggering, shaking the fist, throwing rocks, begging for food, all of these gestures and postures which are performed in the same context that we do and obviously mean the same kind of thing. The complex social structure, the dominance hierarchy, where one male is top ranking and others try to take over that position, sometimes by brute force, and those guys don't last very long. But then there are others who try to get there by using their brains, by using their imagination. They last much longer in that top-ranking position. One simple example, there was this male, Mike, and he was ranked number 11 in a rather unusually large group of adult males at the time. And he had this strong motivation to improve his rank. He wasn't young, he'd lost 2 canine teeth, but he just was so highly motivated. And at that time, there were empty kerosene, paraffin cans, 4-gallon tin cans around my camp, stacked away, but they were there because we lit up the camp with paraffin lighting at night. And he learned to incorporate up to 3 of those cans into what we call the male dominance display, when the male charges across the ground, stamping with his feet, slapping with his hands, picking up and throwing rocks, dragging branches, trying to look bigger and as dangerous as he possibly can to intimidate his rival. Well, Mike, with these 3 cans, hitting them ahead of him as he charged towards other males, initially his superior, they got out of the way, and then they came and groomed him. And within a 4-month period, Mike made it to number 1 position, as far as we know, without even having to fight. So there are these big differences in intelligence. And it was very clear right from the beginning that the chimpanzees had very different personalities. Some were gentle and more loving, some were impatient and more aggressive. It was very clear. And gradually over the years too, it became clear that there were some females who were good mothers, patient and tolerant and supportive, and others who were much less good mothers. And that the offspring of the good mothers had a much better chance as they grew older, could establish better relationships with other chimpanzees, played a more important role in the reproductive life of their community. The community, by the way, at Gombe, about 50 individuals, adult males, females, adolescents, juveniles, and infants. So there were all these differences in personality. And then there was what always fascinated me so much, the relationship, the developing relationship between mothers and their growing offspring and between brothers and sisters. And the female doesn't have a baby until she's 12 or 13. Then she has 1 child every 5 years or so. And these bonds last throughout this long life that can be up to 70 years. Although in the wild we think they don't normally live more than about 50 because there's diseases and internal parasites and things like that. But watching these bonds develop through life has been absolutely fascinating. And we now have this long-term record, which is all in our university in America being digitized so that students from around the world will be able to make use of this very unique long-term record on individuals and their development throughout life. One story. Let's imagine we're following an adolescent female. I named her Pom. She's about 9 years old. And her little brother, Prof, 3 years, still a bit unsteady on his feet, and the mother is way behind. and we're going through this forest along a narrow trail, and there are vines hanging down and ferns up alongside the trail, and little specks of sunlight coming down through the canopy. And suddenly Pom, who's leading, stops, and she stares at something on the ground ahead of her, and her hair begins to stand on end, which is a sign of fear. And ooh, wah, wah, little small sound, which is fear. She rushed up a tree. Little brother, maybe he doesn't hear that sound. Anyway, he carries on along the trail, and the closer he gets to this, the more agitated his sister, until every hair is standing on end. She has this big grin of fear on her face, and finally she can't bear it any longer, and she rushes down, picks up her little brother, climbs up, and there, coiled up at the side of the trail, is a big poisonous snake. I could tell you so many of those stories, these supportive, affectionate relationships that last throughout life, and that makes the chimpanzees, probably next to human beings and the other great apes, so absolutely fascinating to study. It was a big shock for me when I learned that although I thought they were like us but nicer, in certain situations they can be violent, brutal, and aggressive, even showing a kind of primitive warfare. And the males of a community will patrol the boundaries of their territory, and if they see strangers, members of another community, they may chase them, and if they catch that unfortunate individual, usually it's a female, subject her to a really serious, brutal attack and leave her to die of her wounds. And infants may be killed during these attacks. And it was a shock for me. But we have to remember, too, that they also show qualities of caring and compassion and true altruism, as when a non-related member of the community will adopt a little infant and save its life after the mother dies. So here they are, so like us. It's very clear, isn't it? There isn't a sharp line dividing us from the rest of the animal kingdom. We're part of that amazing animal kingdom. And yet, when I went to Cambridge University, because Lewis Leakey told me I had to get a degree, and I wouldn't be able to stand on my own 2 feet unless I had a degree, and there wasn't time for me to get a BA, I would have to go to Cambridge for a PhD. So you can imagine I was a bit nervous. I mean, I'd never been to college. And here were all these erudite professors. And my goodness, they immediately told me, my whole study had been done wrong. First of all, I shouldn't have given the chimpanzees names. They should have had numbers. That was the scientific way. And I couldn't talk about them having personalities. I couldn't talk about them having minds capable of any kind of thinking. And I absolutely couldn't talk about them having emotions like happiness, sadness, fear, despair, and so on, because those were qualities unique to us, they told me. But fortunately, all through my childhood, I had this wonderful teacher. And he taught me that, of course, animals have personalities. Of course, they can work out simple problems. Of course, they have emotions, sometimes just the same as ours. And that teacher, that was my dog, Rusty, he taught me that. You, many of you have dogs or cats or something like that, and you know it's true. You cannot share your life in a meaningful way with an animal and not know that the professors were wrong. And so fortunately, I was able to have the courage of my conviction, and what Cambridge taught me was how to write about these things in such a way that I wouldn't be torn apart by scientific colleagues. So I learned a lot at Cambridge, and I loved that life. And went back and went on collecting data and built up the research station there with students from around the world. And it was a dream sort of life. And why did I leave? Well, I left because in 1986, we brought together all the scientists studying chimpanzees across Africa at that time, and some who were studying chimps in zoo groups. And we had a session on conservation, And it was utterly shocking to see right across Africa, everywhere where chimps were being studied, the numbers were dropping fast. The habitat was being destroyed. That was the beginning of the bushmeat trade, the commercial hunting of wild animals for food. And forests were just disappearing. And we also had a session on conditions in some captive situations, secretly filmed video from medical research labs. Our closest living relatives who can live to be 60 or 70 in cages, in prisons, 5 foot by 5 foot. Measure it out when you go home, 5 foot by 5 foot. There because they're so like us. There because we decided to use their bodies to do research which might help us. And so the chimpanzees were disappearing across Africa. I went to that conference. I had a dream life. I was in this wonderful paradise place, and I was building up a research station. I was analyzing data. I was doing some teaching. I had a child by then, and I left as an activist because I realized it was time for me to do something, anything I could, to try to help the chimpanzees. It was soon after that that I flew in a small plane over Gombe National Park and the area all around it. So as I've said, it's on the shore of Lake Tanganyika. And when I arrived in 1960, had I flown over that whole region, I would have seen unbroken forest all the way along the lake, just a few clearings for villagers, the odd little town. I could have climbed up, as I did actually, onto the peaks of the rift escarpment and looked out away from the lake. Forests as far as you could see, chimp habitat as far as you could see. And then when I flew over in the early 90s and looked down, I was utterly shocked. I knew there was some deforestation outside the park, but I was looking down onto a little oasis, 30 square miles of forest, surrounded by completely bare hills. And it was obvious there were more people living there than the land could support. It was obvious the land had been over-farmed, and there was terrible erosion, and the streams were silting up, and people were struggling to survive. So how could we even try to save these precious chimpanzees when people were living in such a dire situation? And that's what led to the Jane Goodall Institute's program, Take Care or Takari, to help the people living initially just in the villages around Gombe, 12 villages, with a small grant from the European Union, and a very amazing person who joined our team at the beginning, who's German, George Strunden. And what he did was put together a team of Tanzanians, and the Tanzanians went into these 12 villages, not with the arrogance of so much well-meaning but misplaced foreign aid. Well, we see that you've made a mess of things and this is what we're going to do to make your lives better. No. The team went in, the Tanzanian team, and they sat down and they listened. They listened to the elders. They listened to the women. They asked them, what do you feel we could do that would help you? And although we initially went in with conservation in mind, they weren't interested in conservation. They wanted to grow more food. They wanted better health care, and they wanted better education for their children. So that's where we began, working with the local Tanzanian authorities, because we had very little money. And then, as they began to trust us, we were able to introduce some of the other programs that we thought would be beneficial, like water projects, like hygiene, and programs to reforest the slopes so that the streams could come back and flow again. And then we introduce what I believe is the most significant of all, and that's microcredit, based on the Grameen Bank, mostly groups of 5 women. 2 men can join in if they wish, but mostly they don't. And the women can take out little tiny loans for environmentally sustainable projects. And the rate of return is around 90%. Usually if they can't pay back, it's because a family member has died. It's empowering women
for the first time they have their own projects, for the first time they get their own money. And it's been shown all around the world that as family size increases, so as women's education increases, family size tends to drop. And the rate of population growth in this area of Tanzania is very, very high. So this seemed important and was welcomed when we brought in family planning information. And we try and get money for scholarships to keep girls in school, because if there's just a little bit of money, it's usually the boys that get those opportunities. So that is our program to improve the lives of the villagers. I mentioned Shadrack Kamenia earlier. He's very much involved in this program. We now work in 52 villages. It's been reckoned to be one of the best programs of its kind, community-centered conservation in Africa. We're replicating it in the Democratic Republic of Congo, in Uganda, in Congo-Brazzaville, and to some extent in Senegal and Gabon, with different Jane Goodall institutes. So that's what we're doing, and it's working. And now the people in the villages have sat down with our mapping people and looked at maps of their village land and have agreed to put the land they're required to set aside for conservation, the forest land. They've agreed to set this land in a sort of belt around the tiny Gombe National Park. And after 6 years, there are 20, 30-foot trees growing there. It's extended the area of the park. And with other villages less close to Gombe, we see the beginning of a leafy corridor, which ultimately will link up the Gombe chimps with another remnant chimpanzee group in the south. So this program is working. It's giving us hope. But the rest of Africa, it's pretty grim. The extent of the poverty, the ethnic violence, the soil erosion, the deforestation. And it's not just Africa, it's other developing countries. And we find that as the forests go, so you have terrible soil erosion and the spreading of the desert and the always decreasing amounts of fresh water and the loss of biodiversity, which is added to by the chemicals that we spray on the land that are leached down into the water by the rain, the air pollution, the land pollution, the water pollution, you all know about it, and it's pretty grim. And then in addition, there's our burning of fossil fuels and the other greenhouse gases, much of which today comes from methane gas. And huge amounts of methane gas are now produced by the enormous number of cattle and pigs and other livestock that are being mass produced for a world where more and more people are getting richer and wanting to eat more and more meat. And it's not just the methane gas adding to the so-called greenhouse gases leading to climate change. It's also the huge areas of rainforest cut down to provide grazing for the cattle or to grow corn for the livestock. And there are many other downsides to this intensified meat eating that we could talk about. And there are many other problems that many of you know about that face the planet today. It's pretty grim times. Setting aside all your agricultural land in Germany, or so much of it, to grow corn for fuel, and huge monocultures spreading over the land. I could go on about all this, but I won't, because that's not what I'm here to talk about. But it's, as I was traveling around and talking to people about all these problems, the crippling poverty, and not just in developing countries, but in the very heart of the most developed nations in the world, like the Native American communities in North America and the First Nation in Canada, and the poverty we find in parts of the UK, and I'm sure with the Turkish communities in Germany, everywhere we find this poverty and wealth, and then a whole lot of people in the middle. Not surprising
that as I was traveling around the world, talking about the problems facing the chimps and how these were interrelated with all these other problems that face the planet, that I met many young people who seemed not to have much hope for the future. Most of them I found to be just apathetic. They didn't seem to really care. But there were some who were really, really depressed, and there were some who were really, really angry, even violent. And when I began talking to these young people, they all said more or less the same, we feel this way because we feel you have harmed our future and there's nothing we can do about it. Well, when I meet a young child, and I meet them all the time, and I think how we've harmed this planet since I was their age, it gives me a feeling of desperation. Yes, we have compromised the future of our young people, but is it true that there's nothing we can do about it? Before I go on to hope and what we can do, I want to go back to the chimpanzees because I talked a lot about the similarities between them and us, but we all know there are differences. I mean, look, here we are sitting in this conference center or whatever it is, and I'm talking to people who work for a quite sophisticated company, Heidelberg Cement, and we've got lighting, I hear that we are beaming out to people around the world. It's very sophisticated. And so if we think about chimpanzees, yes, they're way, way more intelligent than we used to think. They can do incredible things with computers and touchpads. They can learn 400 or more of the signs of American Sign Language as used by deaf people. They're very smart, but it doesn't make sense to compare a chimp intellect with our intellect. Just think, a little while ago, I can't remember how many months, a rocket was launched and it landed on Mars. And out of this rocket, which unfurled itself, came a little robot. And this little robot has been crawling around on the surface of the red planet, sending back photographs to Earth. That is extraordinary. That is a real triumph of the human intellect. So how is it that this most intellectual creature that's ever walked on planet Earth is destroying its only home? We've only got this one planet. The pictures from Mars make us realize we truly don't want to go and try and live there. It's not at all a friendly looking place. So what's happened? Have we, have we lost wisdom? The wisdom where people made a decision based not on how will it help me now? How will it help me and my family? Me and my company, the next shareholders meeting. How will it help us now? No, now we, instead of asking how it will affect our people generations ahead, we're in this living for the moment, the bottom line, getting as much money as we can now, never mind the future, we may not be here. That seems to me there's been a disconnect between the clever, clever brain, very clever brain, and the rest of humanity, the heart, love and compassion, and thinking. I mean, I don't believe there's a person in this room who doesn't care about children, their own children or their relatives' children. Of course we care about their future. And yet we seem to be divorced from that person who cares about the future of the children to be living in the moment, to be living because of this economic demon that has changed the world, this crazy economic system that tells us we can have unlimited economic growth on a planet with finite natural resources. And it doesn't really make sense. Well, because I was so concerned about young people growing up in this kind of a world, I started this program called Roots and Shoots. Started it in 1991 in Tanzania with 12 high school students. And we gathered together and talked about the problems that they were concerned about. And they wanted me to go and fix them all. And I said, no, I'm not Tanzanian. But you know, they were 17, 18, 19. Why don't you think about what you could do? And that's how the program began. So every group of roots and shoots now chooses three kinds of project to make the world a better place, to help people, to help animals, and to help the environment that we all share. That program that began with such a small group in Tanzania in 1991 is now in 132 countries with about 15,000 active groups and members of all ages from preschool all the way through university. And from Lawrence Kanawha's film, Jane's Journey, we're going to show you just a little segment, the Roots and Shoots segment. It's out of date now. It was filmed about 4 years ago, and there are many more countries than you will see in this little segment. But just look and see, one of my main reasons for hope is the young people. And when they are encouraged, when we listen to them, when they know the problems,
create
it's incredible
what they
can do. Create
a group of young people around the globe who have different values, who understand this life is about more than just making money, that whereas we need money to live, we should not live for money. Young people who understand that money doesn't necessarily make you happy at all once you get more than what you need.
Some call it fate, some call it love. Some call it guidance from above. You are the reason we found us. So thank you, stars. Some people think it's far away. Every day, you are the reason we found out. So thank you, star. There are no winds that can blow it away on the air.
We're letting lots of people know it.
When they try to blow it away. Is when you know we will always be there. To some it's the strength to be a part.
Hello.
To some it's a feeling in the heart. And when you're out there on your own, it's the way back home.
When she came to them and said, well, I want to do this program, and then aptly named it Roots and Shoots, they simply didn't know how to do it.
Well, I hope you can see from that little bit of film, which is just a smidgen of what Roots and Shoots is, that this is one of my greatest reasons for hope. The young people all around the world, even in North Korea, right across mainland China, spreading across Australia, every US state, right throughout Canada, 1,600 groups in the UK alone. And it's everywhere the young people are the same. Once they know the problem, once we listen to them, and once we empower them to take action, they are working to change the world. It isn't that young people can change the world. They are changing the world. And Roots and Shoots is growing in Germany. And I would appeal to any of you who are here, who know children at school, to help us get Roots and Shoots growing bigger than it already is. Help Monica and Lorenz with their effort to grow the program here in Germany. And, you know, stand up strong and let's catch up with the UK. I never thought we'd get 1,600 groups in the UK, but we found some funding, we found the right person, and lo and behold, look what's happened. So my greatest reason for hope is these young people. But then I have other reasons for hope. And next comes the human brain. I've already talked about it. I talked about this rocket that we sent to Mars. It's a bit hard to imagine, but next time you go out and there's a full moon when it's not snowing, go and look up at that moon, or it can be a half moon, it doesn't really matter. Now, we all know that we've had people on the moon. I mean, it's just something we all know. But please go and look at the moon. Just look at it and say to yourself, oh, my goodness, we had somebody walking up on that moon. How amazing is that? It's different when you look at it that way, when you actually look at it way up there in the sky and imagine somebody walking up there. That helps you to understand that if we could all get together and join hands and brains and join brains and heart, that we can do anything. We have the capability. But until we join the brain and the heart, we're not complete human beings. And we can't live a double life with the heart at home and the brain in work. It doesn't work that way. We must become whole human beings. So the brain, however, is an enormous reason for hope, just because of what we can do. And then comes the resilience of nature. And this is where Heidelberg cement comes in. Because I've visited that quarry in Dar es Salaam. I visited it with Roots and Shoots groups from nearby. They showed me the trees that they'd planted. They showed me the nursery where they were growing new plants, indigenous plants, the right kind of plants to put back in the quarry. They told me how they'd been noticing and recording the different birds and insects that had appeared back in the quarry. And I saw it with my own eyes. And that is one example. Now, I hear there are 700 of these quarries that Heidelberg Cement alone is working on around the world. And to know that a place that we have so destroyed and so violated and so disrespected in the past can be given new life, that surely is great reason for hope. Many of you must know places where we have despoiled the natural world, but given time and given some help, it can once again become beautiful and support life. It may not be quite the way it was, it probably won't be, but still it can be a great symbol for the fact that nature is so resilient. An animal species on the very brink of extinction can be given another chance. The last book I wrote was Hope for Animals and Their World, and I mean, the inspiration I got from going around the world meeting these people who had single-handedly sometimes said, I will not allow this animal to become extinct. And now the animal has a second chance. The book I've just finished, Seeds for Hope. The plant kingdom is amazing. I've got a story in there where an Israeli woman got some date palm seeds. They were found in King Herod's mountain fortress, and she's managed to grow one of them. She's trying to grow more. Those seeds were carbon dated 2,000 years. For 2,000 years, those seeds have lain there, waiting for the right conditions so that this magic life can come back and once again make the world beautiful. That's an incredible story, and there are many stories like that. The book comes out in America on April the 2nd, and we're trying to find a publisher here because, again, it's so inspirational. So my second reason for hope, the third reason for hope, the resilience of nature, and finally, the indomitable human spirit, the people who tackle seemingly impossible tasks and will not give up. If we didn't have these indomitable spirits, I would say there's no hope for us in the future because there is so much doom and gloom. There are so many people who say, well, the world's a mess, but there's nothing I can do about it, so they don't do anything. And partly it's our fault. Partly it's because we don't tell them what they can do. Partly it's because we don't imbue them with the Roots and Shoots message that every single one of us impacts the world every single day, and we have a choice as to what kind of impact we're going to make. These indomitable human spirits, you know, there are sort of icons like Nelson Mandela, who emerged from 17 years of hard physical labor with this amazing quality of forgiveness. South Africa's a mess today, but we didn't have the bloodbath that everyone predicted. And then my little mascot, Mr. H. This is Mr. H. And he's actually quite famous. I don't know if you noticed him in the film. He was there. It's the same one. He's about 19 years old now. And he was given to me by one of these amazing people, Gary Horn. And Gary Horn went blind when he was 21 and met a magician. He decided to learn magic. And everybody said, but Gary, you can't be a good magician if you can't see. And he said, well, I can try. And he's so good that the children, he does shows for children, they don't know he's blind. And at the end, he'll tell them and say, you know, things may go wrong in your life, because we never know. But if they do, don't give up. There's always a way forward. And he does skydiving. He's climbed Mount Kilimanjaro in Tanzania. And he does all these crazy things that some blind people do. He thought he was giving me a stuffed chimpanzee for my birthday 19 years ago. And I made him hold the tail. I said, Gary, you've no excuse. Chimpanzees don't have tails. He said, well, never mind. Take him where you go, and you know my spirit's with you. So he's been with me now to 59 countries. He's been to North Korea twice. That's quite something. And he's been touched by about 4 million people, because I say when you touch him, the inspiration rubs off. So he's my little traveling companion. And I have to say in ending that the life I lead is crazy. 300 days a year on the road, writing books in between. It's a pretty busy life, and sometimes it gets a bit almost overwhelming. But on the positive side, it's because I'm traveling, it's because I'm going to all these places that I have the opportunity of meeting some of these inspirational people. I have the opportunity of learning about projects like the Heidelberg cement quarries and the renovation of them. And it's that and meeting the young people, the children all around the world, who all share the same sense of hope and determination. That's what gives me hope. And so I'm really happy to have had the opportunity to be here tonight and to talk to all of you. And if you want to know more, well, I know the Lawrence's film is on DVD now, so I'll sell it for him, Jane's Journey. And again, thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you.
So, thank you. So, thank you. Thank you very much, Mrs. Goodall. Thank you for reminding us that indeed we are part of this amazing animal kingdom. Thank you for telling us about responsibility, about love, compassion, wisdom, and for reminding us not to leave our hearts at home when we come to work. Thanks a lot for that. As a very small gift and a very modest gift, in addition to our recognition, of course, we have a small box of chocolate for you. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for being there. Yeah, indeed. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. So, thanks a lot again. I think we'll have the opportunity to discuss with you just after this, the ceremony, the German and the international ceremony of the Quarry Life Award. After these inspiring words, indeed, we will come to this part of the evening dedicated to recognition to the winners of our competition. We have prepared for you a very short film with footage from many countries, with interviews of managers from Heidelberg Cement, of contestants, of jury members of the 18 countries which took part to the Quarry Life Award contest. So it's just to give you a flavor about what happened during the last 18 months within the mining sites of Heidelberg Cement.
Heidelberg Cement is one of the largest building material producers in the world. In more than 40 countries, the group manufactures high-quality products people need in their everyday life. The principle of sustainable development plays an important role for the company by taking responsibility for both society and nature. In its quarries and gravel pits, the company's commitment towards the environment becomes tangible. At Heidelberg Cement, the flora and fauna protection already start during the quarrying activities. Excavated areas are immediately followed by rehabilitation and become valuable habitats for a large variety of animal and plant species. In order to promote the uniqueness and diversity of habitats in quarries, Heidelberg Cement launched the Quarry Life Award. Quarries from all over the world opened their doors to project contestants. During several months, students and scientists collected, tested, and promoted their ideas about these unique habitats and species.
Есть, может быть, отчасти предупреждение, что любая деятельность человека, она негативна.
There is a prejudice that any human activity affects nature adversely. However, it's known that some species benefit from it. They successfully adjust to the environment, which has become more appropriate for them than it used to be. It's very important to understand that, investigate, and make conclusions.
Projects ranged from biodiversity management during extraction to scientific research on endangered species, and even included projects to educate school children.
Through our project, we want to show children that an exhausted quarry is much more than a dead lunar landscape and disprove this deep-rooted stereotype. We want to demonstrate that such quarry has a potential to become an oasis in our agricultural countryside, where plants and animals that have no room or chance to survive elsewhere can live and be found. The main idea of the project is to show which species utilize the habitats quarries in high altitudes offer, and to see how the quarry itself impacts the species abundance inside and outside the quarries. I wanted to see which species are found in the quarry and which species depend on the quarry in this region.
The main target of the Quarry Life Award is to raise the knowledge of the biological value of quarrying sites and contribute to the protection of biodiversity. However, it proved to be much more than that.
Titones project Quarry Life Award ძალიან მნიშვნელოვანია რადგანაც ის საშუალებას აძლევს.
The project Quarry Life Award is very important since it allows beginners, students, graduates, or already formed professionals to express their innovative ideas and implement interesting projects.
The most valuable thing we get from this contest is the fact that Tvornica Cementa Kakaň provided us this great opportunity to positively influence the biodiversity in the Rybnica quarry. Our NGO, Eco Kakaň, is for the first time experiencing such type of project related to a quarry. So it is a great honor and pleasure for us to participate in this contest. It is a great challenge above all, and we hope that this project will be of some assistance for future ecological projects that we are going to implement.
QLA. It is a great idea, an original one. It is good that it is an international contest. Thus, everything that we are doing here at Garajje has also an international aspect of transferring the ideas to other countries. We can compare ourselves with other countries, nations, learn about other systems of protection for biodiversity. For sure, the idea is splendid and should be continued in next editions of Quarry Life Award.
Over the course of the summer, national jury members and international jury members actively followed the projects as they developed.
It is exciting to see the variety of projects and ideas coming from different countries. And indeed, the Quarry Life Award connects the countries through their projects. Of course, there is rivalry, but it benefits the great idea of a global award.
There was one particular project in which a contestant was looking at how biodiversity is enhanced in a place where rehabilitation takes place by looking at butterflies. That was something very interesting for me.
The contest was very keen.
The Quarry Life Award was a very keen project. And as a jury member, I realized that the selection of projects was not easy because people came from different angles. They brought different things to the table. To judge whether one idea was better than another was not an easy task. But then I realized that people had different opinions about looking at things and how they could help the biodiversity ambitions of the award. So we looked at it from this angle and thought that we should go for the best innovative ideas. And that is what we did.
80 projects from 18 countries were carried out in the first edition of the International Quarry Life Award. All these projects, although being in competition, connected participants from all over the world with each other and opened up new perspectives. They made the Quarry Life Award a starting point for long-lasting partnerships for the benefit of biodiversity.
Now, when various directions of environmental projects are being implemented in Georgia, we try to realize them in accordance with Western standards used by the civilized world. In this regard, the project is very important. And in fact is setting a precedent here when such a large company as Heidelberg Cement organizes such contest. How to bring the quarry to natural conditions again. It was so unprecedented and interesting that of course the Ministry of Environmental Protection supported this idea, this project, and we became partners. Our partnership will also continue in the future. We plan to have more partnerships with universities and NGOs. NGOs, because they are a good input for our operations, and they are also a good partner for getting us to think about issues we normally do not have in mind. They are the voice of our communities around the factory. We also like to have universities on board, because they are full of young people, and young people are the future of Twiga Cement. They are also the future of Tanzania.
The
students of our finalist group and their teachers were all in a very good mood, and very motivated right from the start. They were also very happy to get active for nature protection and already told us that they will continue to support our renaturation measures here at the Nussloch Quarry in the future.
Heidelberg Cement is proud to say thank you to the participants of the first Quarry Life Award for their dedicated work and scientific expertise. They have made this competition a great success, and nature the biggest winner.
So indeed, thank you to these participants. And you can find some additional information about the projects and about the winners of all national contests on the website www.quarrylifeaward.com. You can also sign up for updates about the implementation of these projects in the future and about the next edition of the Quarry Life Award, which is to start in fall 2013. A short word about the public voting. Through the website, we also organized a public vote. So you should know that we had over 60,000 visitors, individual visitors, on the website of Quarry Life Award. And we recorded 15,000 votes. And the winner, with 4,800 votes, so the winner comes from Ukraine. The name of the winner is Sergei Smetana, with the project of transportable biodiversity centers creation in the Tseltokamenka quarry, I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly, in Ukraine. And this project is about the creation of endangered steppe plants communities in artificial sockets, which is a way to speed up the development of habitats that can follow closely behind the mining activities. So congratulations to this public vote winner.